They were war crimes, as is the continued holding of hostages. The collective punishment by Israel of Palestinian civilians amounts also to a war crime, as does the unlawful forcible evacuation of civilians. The massive bombardments by Israel have killed, maimed, and injured, in particular, women and children. The latest death toll that we got from the Gaza Ministry of Health is in excess of 10,500 people, including over 4,300 children and 2,800 women. All of this has an unbearable toll on human lives, on civilians. We have fallen off a precipice, and this cannot continue. Even in the context of a 56-year-old occupation, the current situation is the most dangerous in decades. Faced by people in Gaza, first and foremost, then in Israel, in the West Bank, but also regionally. During my visit here, I heard a lot of concerns expressed to me about double standards in the midst of this conflict. Let me be clear, the world cannot afford double standards. We must instead insist upon the universal standards against which we must assess this situation. And this is about international human rights law and international humanitarian law. Gaza has already been described as the world's biggest open-air prison before the 7th of October. Under a 56-year-old occupation and a 16-year blockade by Israel. The atrocities that were perpetrated by Palestinian armed groups on the 7th of October were heinous, brutal, and shocking. They were war crimes, as is the continued holding of hostages.
My second question would be...
Yes, we were just saying...
It's an enormous pleasure. There are violations by Hamas when they have human shields. But when one looks at the number of civilians that were killed with the military operations, there is something that is clearly wrong. Every year, the highest number of killing of children by any of the actors in all the conflicts that we witness is the maximum in the hundreds. We had, in a few days in Gaza, thousands and thousands of children killed, which means there is also something clearly wrong in the way humanitarian operation, military operations are being run.
So far, your demands have largely gone unheeded. So what is the plan?
It's absolutely essential that all hostages are released immediately and unconditionally. We are in intense negotiations with Israel, with US, with Egypt, in order to make sure that we have an effective humanitarian aid to Gaza. Until now, it has been too little, too late. Terrible, catastrophic, I would say, humanitarian situation. Lack of medicine in hospitals. So it is absolutely essential to have a flow of humanitarian aid into Gaza that corresponds to the dramatic needs that the population is facing. And I would like to say very clearly, this in nothing should reduce our total rejection for the horrible things that Hamas did the 7th of October. But we need to distinguish. Hamas is one thing, the Palestinian people is another. If we don't make that distinction, I think it's humanity itself that loses meaning.
You said you're talking to the Israeli authorities. What are you telling them to basically to allow yourselves to enforce and even expand your humanitarian remit in Gaza? And crucially, what are they telling you? Give us an update on where those talks are going, because on the ground, we are not seeing much.
It's essential that the laws of war are respected. One of the great conquests that we had are the fourth Geneva Conventions. The laws of war must be respected by everybody and entirely, not a la carte. It is also important to make Israel understand that it is against the interest of Israel to see every day the terrible image of the dramatic humanitarian needs of the Palestinian people. That doesn't help Israel in relation to the global public opinion.
Record number of UN employees have been killed in this conflict.
92.
What are you doing to keep your people safe, and how are you seeking accountability?
It is impossible to keep people safe because, I mean, they have to do their job. I pay tribute to your colleague that was killed. And the number of journalists, by the way, killed in this conflict is unique, never seen in such a period anywhere in the world. But you can imagine what it is to run an organization that is working in the field with 92 colleagues that already have been killed. This is, I must tell you, very difficult.
Will the UN take the lead maybe during the years of the recovery in Gaza?
I think there is a best case scenario, and I think we should try to work for that best case scenario. And it's important to give hope to the Palestinian people. For me, the best case scenario would be that after the military operations end, the Palestinian Authority, and hopefully a revigorated Palestinian Authority, would be able to assume political control in Gaza. There is, of course, a transition that needs to be defined between what is the Israeli occupation and the future solution. Several entities can play a role. The UN can play a role. Several countries that are relevant in the region can play a role. The United States can play a role. So, this is something that, of course, needs to be discussed with Palestinians, with Israelis. And then to have this as a starting point of a serious negotiation for a two-state solution. Because I believe sometimes the worst tragedies become an opportunity.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary General.
Thank you very much.